gathered together this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Cindy. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us your aid so we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. At this time, I'd like to welcome Jason to come up and to say a few words.
Extremely emotional and a challenging time for me. Losing your mother is a deeply painful experience. It came with a lot of emotions. I'm also grateful that this room is filled with so many people that knew and cared for my mom. See that tremendous love and support for my mom and my family is humbling and inspiring. Thank you for taking the time today to be here. It means a lot to us. My mind just wants to reject all of this. This is reality. My mom is no longer with us in this world. I do not know how to summarize or speak about her entire life. So today I'm going to speak about the relationship I have with my mom. I hope you come away with a greater appreciation for what an incredible, inspiring woman she was. In our time together, my mom taught me some of life's most important lessons. She did so in some unique and inspiring ways, and I'll speak of some of those lessons today. The first lesson my mom taught me was belief. During my life, she showed me absolute and unshakable belief in me. As a child, she showed me this, whether it was simply going out and playing basketball and her rooting me on, or even on my lows when I get caught shoplifting or something. Don't get me wrong, she was a mother. She was mad. If you all knew my grandpa, my mom was the same way. She let me have it. And in the next breath, she would tell me how she still believed in me, how I have a good soul, and she knew I'd be all right. Now, after I had graduated high school, I was not the best son a mother could have at those times of my life. But no matter what I did, or how far I ventured away from her, she was always there for me. With open arms, and always telling me how she believed in me. Just this past week, going through a bunch of old boxes of pictures my mom just had all over the place, I ran across a Mother's Day card I probably gave her when I was in fifth or sixth grade. And I told her the normal, have a good day, love your mom. And then at the bottom of that, for some reason, and I don't know today why, but I had written, P.S. Thank you for always believing in me. And with all those actions, she created the belief that drives me today. And I think this is the best thing you can do for anyone is believe in them. The second lesson my mom taught me was the power of compassion. She was one of the most compassionate people I've ever known. She would listen without judgment, give without expectation, help out because it was the right thing to do, and she was honest because there was no other way. Just a couple of little stories, again, that I've just had this past week. Monday morning was a very painful morning for me. So I'm carrying boxes up to my mom's apartment. I get up there, drop some off. She lived in the same towers where there's elevators. So I'm sitting there waiting for the elevator to come up. And then over here, a bunch of her friends in the solarium, wondering who's gonna do what for who now. Because my mom would do anything and everyone for all her friends and ladies in the taking the Walmart, doctor's offices, wherever they would need, they could depend on my mom. And that just struck me really, really deeply just listening to that. I wasn't part of the conversation, I just overheard it, but just everyone wondering, what do we do now? My mom's gone, who's going to pitch in and help. Later on that week, as me and my family were trying to get boxes down from her apartment, my mom used to have a little red wagon that she would take her groceries out. Mom was old, back pain, she couldn't carry it. So we're looking all over her apartment for this little red wagon of hers. And come to find out that she had given it away to someone else she felt needed it more than she did. Just a couple of examples of the compassion she had for everyone she had come across to in her life. And she's had this mentality all through her life. She just always had to take care of people. It's just the way my mom was. Very compassionate, didn't care what it did to her, just as long as she was there to help anyone in need. Third lesson I kind of learned from my mom, and I'm still learning, I'm not very good at it, is to be authentic. My mom was one of a kind. My mom lived this way. She wanted to say or do something, she did it. With no remorse, no worry of what anyone ever thought of her. Kind of rambling on. I was told to stay with what I've written and I got off, so. She never worried where she stood. You never had to worry where you stood with my mom. She would tell you the way it was. She got that from her dad. She never lied, she just told you the way it was, whether it was good or bad. She'd tell me when I'd done wrong. She told me when I did right. I think there was a lot more wrong than right, but she let me know how she felt about everything. We all know my mom. She was just a huge ball of energy. No matter what she did it with laughter, happiness, whether it was singing, dancing, going out and having to scream out at the farm. Just another little reminder. The last day I got to see her was last Friday for the Husker game. My little mom would sit there. She'd come to my house pretty much every game. And she'd just sit there, silent as can be. But of course, when we score or anything, she would let out that little scream that she does. And everybody here knows what I'm talking about. So in conclusion, I'm going to miss her deeply. How could I not? It's my mom. But I know she will always be with me. Her belief in me, compassion for others, and showing me how to be authentic and not care what other people always thought about me. So I love you, Mom, and I will miss you deeply. And I did write a P.S. She loved her cats.
I've been asked now to invite anyone else that might like to say a few words to come up at this time and say a few words.
And stay the night at her house and We would watch movies together and we would have fun. I would drive her wherever she needed to go.
Happy birthday. She always went to and we hugged her game. She every time, just like my dad said, we score a touchdown, she will have so much fun and just be excited whenever she could.
We loved it when we would hang out with her. So it was something we liked to do.
I'm Lois McFarland. I'm Cindy's aunt. And I want to tell you about the first day that our Cindy girl was born. In 1953, in April, my sister Doris and Greg were married. And in May, Greg left for the Army. And Doris worked for a while shortly after that. And then she was pregnant. And so she came to live with us on the farm. And I was 11, my brother was 7, and my sister and I shared a bedroom upstairs, and I remember the night that she woke up and was very restless, and she woke me up and she said, "I think you better get dressed, I think we're going to the hospital." And so we told Mom and Dad that, and in the middle of the night, my dad got up and was shaving. And my mom was so upset, it's like, "What are you doing this for?" And he said, "Well, we're going to the hospital. I have to be presentable." I remember putting my sister's shoes on. She couldn't tie her shoes. Her black and white saddle shoes, I remember tying those for her. And then my mom called my other sister, Marge, and said, "We're headed to the hospital. We're bringing Lois and David to you." And so we were at my sister's house when Cindy June was born. She was the sweetest baby girl. And at 11 years old, I thought, how wonderful we get a baby back in this house again. So just wanted to let you know how Cindy started her life. And she was 3 months old when Greg came home from Korea and came back to a wife and a brand new baby. So that's how long we have loved our Cindy. She was a wonderful person and will be missed by so many. I know, especially her families here. But just let you know how much she loved each one of you, and she loves so deeply. And so all of you need to remember that and live your life just like she did. Thank you.
Our first scripture for the day comes out of Luke, the 14th chapter. Then Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." Our psalm is the 23rd psalm. "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Our final lesson comes out of the Gospel of John, the 11th chapter. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now the town of Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Here ends the readings.
When Christ shall come.
join with me in prayer. Almighty God, as we come before you this morning, as a family mourning the sudden loss of a loved one, we pray that this time and this service would be a time when you are with us, when we know your presence and your comfort. We pray that now during this time that your word might speak to us comfort, that it might speak to us hope and life, that we might continue on in our pilgrimage here. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. As I sat with the family yesterday and heard about Cindy and her life, and what she made of the substance of her life, I was given in my mind that first lesson from the Gospel of Luke to read. It's not a traditional funeral passage, but I heard about her love and her service to everyone. That she didn't just go out to find the people that could repay her back, but that she often looked for those who had no means at all to do anything, let alone repay her back. Heard about on bases, across the seas, at holidays, many single men being invited over for holidays, for meals. And it just reminded me of those words that Jesus said. When you give a banquet, don't invite your friends, your family, your rich neighbors who might repay you back, but invite the crippled, the poor, the lame, and you'll be blessed. For though they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. And that is the thing that we long for. That day of resurrection. That day when we see the promise that Jesus made come true. He came in our other gospel lesson to the town of Bethany, where Mary and Martha had lost their brother Lazarus. Not only had they lost him, but they had sent word a couple of days in advance of his death to Jesus to say, "Come at once, your servant who you love is sick." And Jesus waited. By the time he showed up, Lazarus had been in the grave already for 4 days. And the sisters were hurt, wondering where God was in the midst of all of that, wondering what Jesus was doing, not coming quicker. And both of them, the first words out of their mouths at separate times when they greet him was, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." And I would almost guarantee you that we've had similar questions for God during this time. Cindy wasn't, though Jason described her as old, Cindy wasn't old. That's to placate everyone sitting behind Jason. And there's that question, where's God in all this? To have somebody who cared so much for the people that she was around, to have somebody that her neighbors all depended on, to have somebody who always looked for the good, to have somebody who always invited and trusted the stranger. To have someone like that taken. Where is God in all of this? What is he doing? Why? If you had been here, God, our Cindy would still be alive. And it's difficult. It's difficult during times like this to try to make any sense of it. It's difficult at any time to try to crawl into the mind of God and figure out why he does the things that he does. And that's not necessarily what our job as humans is to do. Because there are many events in our lives that we cannot make sense of. There are many things that happen to us, good and bad, that if we try to explain them, leave us unsatisfied or worse, hurt at the explanations we might give ourselves. But Jesus doesn't give any explanations to the sisters. He doesn't show up and give excuse as to why he didn't come. He says this, "Your brother will live again." And the promise that Jesus gives there is a promise not only to the sisters, but to all who would believe in him. The sisters say, "Well, yeah, I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day." And Jesus says to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, though they die, will live. And anyone then who lives believing in me will never die." The promise that your brother will rise again is not an isolated thing going on for those sisters. The promise that the dead will rise in Jesus is a promise for humanity. Is a promise for each and every one of us. Due to sin, due to our condition that leads to chaos and death, we die. But by the grace of God given us in Jesus Christ, death is not the end. Cindy will rise again. That is the promise that Jesus speaks to us right now. The love that she had for you, the care that she had for each and every one of you, will come again to you in the resurrection. And one day we will be raised as well. One day we too will be changed. And these old ways of sin, of death, of mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For Jesus, the resurrection and the life, will have done away with them. And Jesus gives us that question. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? If right now you're asking yourself whether or not you do believe in Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, I'll finish the story for you. He goes off with the sisters to the graveyard. And he tells them, roll the stone away from your brother's grave. And they say, Lord, there's already a stench. He's been in there 4 days. And he says to them, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? And they roll away the stone. And in the stench of death, Jesus cries, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man comes out. Jesus raises the dead. Those who believe in him, though they die, will live. And in moments like this, where we cannot make sense nor explain the ways of God, are given that promise. Though you don't understand, those who believe will live again. And so we go on in this life, not necessarily understanding everything, but trusting in our God through it. I was told that plastered all over Cindy's apartment was the Serenity Prayer. How many of you guys familiar with the Serenity Prayer? God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Simple. But did you know there's more? And doing a little Googling, the Serenity Prayer, as it was published originally in 1951, reads differently. And I hope that today, for you, the extended version will give you a little more to grasp as you move forward. God, give me grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed. Courage to change the things which should be changed. And the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did this sinful world as it is, not as I would have it. Trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen. One day, he will make all things right. One day, our Cindy will live again. Until then, God, give us grace in this life. Amen. Would you join with me in prayer? God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks because by his death, Jesus destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection has opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Would you join with me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Cindy. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Let us go forth in peace in the name of Christ. Amen.
Didn't know today would be our last. my troubles for your soul.